Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this, your sunset safari. The sun is very far from setting. That is a Cokie Franklin. My name is James Henry. Brian's on camera, and this is Safari Live. Hello everybody, again, there is a little Cokie Franklin. Perfect way to start our sunset safari. Look how beautifully camouflaged it is for this time of the day and at this time of the year. And by this time of the day, of course, I mean that harsh light that's coming down out of the African spring sky, but perfectly just blending there with the grass and the leaves. Isn't she sweet? That's a female Cokie Franklin. There's a whole little covey of them. That's the collective noun that we use for Franklins and game birds, as people call them. It's an unfortunate term, of course, meaning birds that people like to shoot on the wing. Not myself, of course. So Brian is on camera. He will show you his thumb, but just not yet, because we're too far zoomed in. On the other vehicle, we've got Jimmy Patterson, of course. She's being filmed by Jandre, Mowgli, I suppose, Gerding. And in the final control, we have Louise Pavide and Geraldine the Cheesecake, the giraffe, today. And if you're wondering why I'm calling her that, she is in fact dressed, and I kid you not, in a giraffe onesie this afternoon. Why, you might ask? No one really knows. We'll try and get you a picture of that and send it to you. We'll tweet it, hashtag SafariLive. Which brings me to the next topic of conversation, the way you can talk to us. It would be lovely to hear from you during the course of the afternoon. Hashtag SafariLive if you're tweeting away, like... There are no birds tweeting right now, so you'll have to tweet on your own at the whatever tone you like. Hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Otherwise, you can talk to us on the email questions at wildearth.tv. Brian, would you kindly show us your thumb and tell us what it is?
There it is.
What is it?
A strange thumb.
Is it just a strange thumb?
It is.
There, everybody.
Peculiarly strange thumb.
Is a peculiarly strange thumb, because all of the other thumbs are not peculiar at all. Okay, Jamie Patterson has got some animals to show you. I'm going to speed towards cheetah plains to get to those waterholes and see what's come to drink on this hot day. See you there.
And a very good afternoon to all of you. It's lovely to have you on board with us for this glorious sunset safari. And as you can see, starting off our safari experience with a herd of elephants, admittedly a very difficult to see herd of elephants, so they're hiding away, trying to, I think, shelter from the sun. It's, as James might have mentioned, quite a warm spring afternoon here in the African bush, which of course is lovely, but it does mean that for the animals like the elephants and everything else, they're all trying to hide about in the shade. There is a beautiful big bull though on his way towards us, so at some point I think he's going to push the slightly smaller and younger elephants more out into the open. But good afternoon, my name is Jamie and I have Jandre on camera with me this afternoon, and between the two of us we're going to see what amazing wonders we can find in the African bush. Come on guys. I'm hoping that a bit of a waterhole check might be quite a nice idea. I'm told that there is no more water at Buffleshook Dam, but I might go and check Sydney's and see whether or not any of the elephants have come across and through for a drink to help to relieve themselves from this incredibly warm temperature that we're experiencing. So this morning, dramatic scenes with Shadow and Tingana, our two lead leopard characters, but we'll get into that in a moment. And also another lovely elephant sighting of our snared or three, what we suppose she's more of a two-thirds elephant, but we do call her the half-trunked elephant, a character that has become a firm favourite amongst elephant lovers watching the Safari Live experience. She's definitely one of mine. An elephant missing the tip of her trunk, but I don't think this is her herd. Could be, though. I mean, it's so hard to see them that we actually don't know. You can see now the gwari bushes are the only green things left in this landscape at this point. They somehow managed to maintain that vibrant, vivid green, despite the incredible desiccating effect of the hot winds and the heat as we reach the end of our winter period and our dry season. And it does mean that elephants at this time of day, as we start to go back into summer, are a little bit more short-tempered than they might otherwise be, both with each other and with any other interferences in their day-to-day life. We spoke about it a lot last year, the fact that we were being especially careful with elephants. And that's something, that pattern that we will start falling back onto now in the next, not too distant future. Since they do have, they're sort of burning a slightly shorter fuse than they might otherwise be. Come on, guys. Come say hello. Or is this just the best shady spot that you can find? I think they're just looking for a nice patch to have an afternoon snooze. Somewhere nice and sheltered. Well, the good news is I've just heard Aubrey go out on game drive, which means that we can drive past Galago Pan and just have a double check and see whether there are any remaining elephants at the waterhole there. There's only two water points left on Juma, essentially. Is that true? It is true. There's only two remaining water points. There's Galago Pan and there's Juma Pan. And that's it. That's all that's left. So for our eddies, hold on. Come on. Come on. Come say hello. They are not in any kind of a hurry to be racing off. Especially not since I think they've found the same cooling breeze that is helping Gendre and myself out while we sit here. Well, we play the patience game with our elephants and hope that they decide to pop out. Let's go over to James and a herd of beautiful, elegant antelope.
Yes, indeed, beautiful, elegant antelope. They are disappearing into the bush. It was a brief impala sighting, wasn't it, Brian?
Wonderful.
It was excellent, albeit very brief.
Wait.
Right, have you got... Oh, there we are. Impala. Now, of course, the oddest thing, and I will be banging on about this for a little while, simply because, well, it was a wonderful experience. The interesting thing about the Mara Triangle is that impala occur in very small groups, in really not very many of them at all, and that, of course, is because there's very little standing water in sort of pans like they have here. There's the river, but everything drinks from the river, and so away from the rivers, you don't find impala. You find the impala just living on the fringes of the woodland where the river is. But because there are no pans and things, you find that they don't live anywhere other than that, and that's because they're not migrators. They can't move great distances. They're just simply not designed for it. And it's a great testament, of course, to what the effect that artificial water has had in this particular area. Impala, massively effective grazing and browsing competitors if they have water, which these ones do. They also have lots of bush to hide behind here. You can see that, Brian? Mm-hmm. There's many sticks there. Many. And thorns. Yes. Righty. On we go. No grass. We haven't quite left. I thought maybe we'd see your cheetah plains, everyone, but, I wasn't driving quite at that speed. We're still we're only about half a mile down the road from where we last saw you. Ah, thank you, Aaron. You say you think that a trip to Cheetah Plains on Catterday is a very good idea. Well, on that note, I can tell you that there were no cheetah found on Cheetah Plains today, but that the Styx cubs were found. And we'll go and have a look at them. I'm laughing, of course, because Now, they have been referred to around the camp rather sort of irreverently as the street children of the lion world, which of course they are when you compare them to the fat little things that the Nkuhuma pride are. Well, let's go and see how they're doing. Jamie came back, well, I'd say almost traumatized the other day from seeing them. She said one of them was looking so awful that it was, well, she thought it was almost blind from how swollen its eyes were. Brian, upon that tree is a lilac-breasted roller, gorgeously framed by the spring blue sky. Very nice. Good afternoon, sir. Yes. Well, quite so. Now this bird, it could be a madam, is looking for a grasshopper or some such to grab from the grass. It will be very excited when the rains come and the new grasshoppers hatch from wherever they are. Let's just take a time to appreciate that this is one of the most common birds we get here, and it is magnificent, isn't it? One of three roller species, possibly four. The racket-tailed has been seen once or twice. I don't think it's ever been seen on Safarilive, the racket-tailed roller. It's a roller with a tail that looks like a... Brian?
A racket?
A racket, yes. Well done, a racket-tailed roller. The other two being the purple roller and the European roller, neither of which are nearly as magnificent as their more common cousin, the lilac-breasted roller. What you can hear, I don't know if you can hear it in the background, is another one calling. And as the other one started calling, this one lifted its head and looked. Off to the left-hand side of your screen is a long way away. It's sitting. I can just see where it's sitting. I'm not sure we'd be able to see it with a camera. It's on another dead tree, sort of around about the same height off to the left-hand side. And we'll see if this one... If it's a female, it won't probably react. The other one, if it's a male there, it might want to do a territorial display, which will be incredible to watch, but it seems a little indecisive, doesn't it, Brian? Mm. Either that or a little lazy.
Maybe both.
Lazy and indecisive. Mm. No way to live, really, is it?
No, mm-mm. Not at all.
No. All right, let's move on from this lazy and indecisive lilac-breasted roller. Hello. Oh, he's now calling, but he's not doing anything. Hello, Valeria in Massachusetts. Sorry. Oh, there's the other one. Brian, it's on the dead tree. You got in there. Valeria, you say you're looking forward to going to Cheetah Plains and hoping to see the gangster cubbies. Yes, well, they are very gangster, but they're not a particularly, not obviously don't belong to a very good gang. I think the Nkuhumas are also a bit of a gang, but their gang is substantially more successful, a bit like the mafia, I suppose, versus a, well, low-level street gang. I think they've got a little nest in there, everyone. And I hope this nest lasts longer than the one that I found a little while back, which was blown over by the wind. It's the only bird that's calling. Everything else is completely silent. All right, we'll continue to Cheetah Plains. Jamie is probably at the waterside. I'm going to guess with some buffalo. Let's head across and see.
We were near some water. We went across to Galagopan to see whether or not the elephants or whether there were any sort of latecomers to the drinking circle. Since there are quite a few elephants, this is actually a massive herd that we happened to encounter the sort of the beginning of it. And this is now the back of the breeding herd of elephants. So it's a massive herd. There's probably...
Mm-hmm. Hello again. We are live. These surprising lives are... One has been caught, of course, being surprised live, saying the odd naughty thing, but the last four times I've been surprised, I've managed not to say anything naughty, which is fantastic. Phew, what a relief. It's always a relief when you hear, sorry, you're live, we lost someone else. You think back 5 seconds before you went live and you think to yourself, no, I'm okay, good. And this wave of relief washes through your body. Right, we're heading down towards the Valley of the Great Mbrewamati, and we'll just check to see if Kurula's tracks haven't come across. She went down south this morning, basically at the junction where we came out of Juma. I didn't see her magnificent royal feet, royal pug marks. I think we said 32 degrees, which I think is about, 85 degrees Fahrenheit. So quite pleasant temperature, but quite hot. Certainly not too bad. And the need for great jackets, well, it's slowly ebbing with the season. As the need in most of our audience's parts of the world, of course, for jackets is now going to start to increase. Sorry for you. And it's a very wintry landscape still, and this is the odd thing, of course, is that once we hit spring, we've still got a month or so before everything turns green. Everything is still rather leafless. It will continue to get even more leafless as the spring progresses. And only after the first rains will we get greenery in the clearings, but some of the trees will flush as a response to the lengthening days. There is another herd of impala, Brian. And the call of the golden-tailed woodpecker. Sorry, impala. I'm sorry about that. I had to impersonate the golden-tailed woodpecker, Brian. Can you imagine I hadn't? People wouldn't know what I was talking about. Hello, James Richard. You're wondering about the social dynamics of the Thompson's gazelle, which is, of course, a common gazelle species found in the Mara Triangle. Relatively similar. They don't live in bachelor herds much, really, but they do when they get ready to mate. The males do set up sort of temporary territories in much the same way that the impala do, and the females tend to live in groups in much the same way that the impala do, but they're much smaller, and they're sort of further interspersed, I suppose. They're not quite as large, the smaller groups. This is in my vast experience of 3 days in the Mara, of course. And that's what the textbook I have says as well. But, you know, more time there would give us a greater idea of what happens with the Thompson's gazelle, but it is relatively similar. You'll find that just about all the woodland and grassland antelope have the same sort of social structure, with a male, dominant male, setting up a temporary territory every so often, and the females living in either large or small nursery or breeding groups. Jamie Patterson has found one of the birds that I saw today when we were off air flying overhead. Go and have a look. It's a favourite returnee from close to the camp.
Spring is definitely here, and well done, Jandre, for managing to catch this particular eagle on camera. The beautiful pale morph Wahlberg's eagle that sat really nice and still in the tree for the entire time, right up until the point that James sent you across and over to us. Oh, our Wahlberg's eagles are back once again. Migrants are coming all the way from up north of the Sahara, so they've returned to our shores once again. We've got a pale morph Wahlberg's pair that nests very, very close to where I live, and I'm hoping that this is one of them on its way back. I'm also hoping that it might come back towards us so that we can actually have a proper look. Come on, eagle. It was so good. So good. And no. So they migrate separately, but they do return to the same breeding pairs each and every single year, which is one of those incredible things that we all find so mind-boggling about the different migratory birds. They'll go off, they'll fly thousands in some case of miles, thousands and thousands of miles, return back to their same nest spot, and return to the same mate. It's absolutely mind-boggling the way that they do that. And some people have absolutely no, I mean, scientists have absolutely no idea how some of the birds go and do that. We'll be getting the, the name's just gone, Amur falcons. There we go. They come back into my head. The Amur falcons will be coming back, the one of the few social falcon species. One of the largest migrations of any raptor, in fact, the largest migration of a raptor species in the world. Come on. Can just see it, and it's just that little bit too far, and it keeps ducking and diving that little bit further each time. No, we'll try and find it again. Oh, I think it's safe to say that over the next few weeks we're going to be getting our migratory bird species back from the initial. The Wahlberg's always a little bit earlier, and then you get the later arrivals of the things like the cuckoos and the kingfishers. But I suspect that at some point over the next few months, we're actually going to, depending on what happens with the drought, we're actually going to see less bird variety in terms of summer species arriving. And that's because in answer to Marcus's question, who is sitting in final control, a lot of these bird species are insect eaters, and the insects are going to be hugely hit by the lack of rainfall that we've experienced over the last few, actually the last 2 years. So insect populations are going to plummet. We saw it this year as well. We noticed that we weren't seeing the normal amount of bird species that we might have otherwise, and that was because a lot of them had moved closer towards the Drakensberg Mountains, where there's been a little bit more rainfall, and therefore there's a bit more in the way of insect activity, grass seeds. Just in general, the birds are going to be equally affected by the drought as the sort of the herbivores and the various plant-eating mammals, like the elephants, which have still refused to come out into the open, despite my distraction with the Wahlberg's eagle. And hello to Sean from Secunda. Sean, it's been a while since I've heard your name, actually. I don't know whether it's just because the questions haven't come through to my side, or whether you've been absent from the show for a little bit. The Woodlands kingfishers will be back a little bit later. They're usually one of the last ones to arrive, towards November. End of October, November. I'm just trying to remember, we marked the exact date they arrived back. Oh, there we go, finally. Success. An elephant in the open. We marked the date last year, and for some reason I want to say the 23rd of October. So they're usually one of the last of the migratory species to arrive. Hello, boy. Oh, don't you disappear too? Aww. Okay. Bye then. Our Ellie's just don't want to play ball. But at least we've got this view of this ball for now as he stops glancing back at us. The twisting of the trunk is an almost instant indicator that he's a little bit uncertain. He just wants to stop and think about what he's going to do about our presence. And then he's going to wander off. Very clearly a young male. Jandre, I don't know what it is, you're scaring all the elephants away. Must be Jandre, there can be no other explanation. They are running away from him. He's giving me a very sad look. It's not Gendre. It is not Gendre scaring the elephants away. It's the sun. They're all trying to hide away from it. I think we might have to give up the patience game that we've been playing. One of the big concerns, for us at least, and for the animals in its own way, is the effect that the drought has on the underground water supplies. Hello, do you mind if I come? Let me go forward a bit. You're going to keep walking, I think. Or are you going to do the exact opposite? No. Okay, backwards we go. It's all right. My clutch leg needs the exercise. There we go. How's your view there, Gendre? There's a big tree in the way. Now there is. How's that? That will do. We'll take it. Sorry. Now, one of the big concerns about the drought and the effect that it has on us is the underground water supply. And we do have a question from Yard Bird in Arizona, who I imagine might have experienced similar things in Arizona, coming from Arizona. Yes, it's affected the underground water table, but we're still okay. So for new viewers, all of our water comes from an underground water supply. Hello, little boy. It's okay. Tiny little one. Just on the outskirts of the herd. Not quite independent. So all of our water is pumped up from underneath the ground, which is why often we get asked, can't we supply extra water for the animals? And the answer is no, we can't, because that water has to come from somewhere and we have to manage it and balance the amount that we provide as much as possible. Now those pans that are pumped in front of Galago and Vuyatela to provide the animals with water, that water has to come from somewhere. And that comes up from underground, as well as all of our drinking water, our whatever we happen to use water for, whether it's dishwater, everything comes from beneath the surface of the soil. If we were to run out of water completely, the entire operation and the lodge would shut down. We'd probably try and sink a new borehole, but for now, they have had experts come in and check, and there's still a healthy amount of underground water to keep us supplied. So not a bridge that we have to cross just yet. I know Simbambili is a neighbouring lodge, and I think they lost 3 of their 4 boreholes. So it is definitely something that does happen, and certain places are luckier than others in terms of the amount of water that they have underneath the surface of the soil. I give up on these elephants, I think. They really are making life terribly difficult and all hiding away. I think we'll move on. We'll make our way towards Bucklesworth Dam and do a big loop back towards the Juma Pan as it starts to get dark. All right, little boy, we give in. I give up. Alrighty. So, as we leave our elephants for now, we'll see if we can't find some other more out in the open elephants. This morning was another truly extraordinary sunrise safari, where we had Tingana not mating with Shadow, but basically attempting to escape the area from where he stole Karula's kill yesterday on the sunset safari. So, you know, we were talking about the sort of the soap opera that was unfolding in front of our eyes, and as if we thought it couldn't get more dramatic, the 3 wild dogs racing in at the end, at the very close of drive, I think was probably the clincher on that particular afternoon sighting. And Tingana this morning was still with Shadow, desperately trying to get away from her and from 3 hyenas, which included Bella, the matriarch's young male, those of you who are familiar with our different hyenas, that had come racing through and decided to chase both of them up a tree. Tingana, without too much ado, shot up a marula tree and found himself a really comfortable spot, leaving no space at all for poor Shadow, who then had to go and find herself a slightly less appropriate tree. It was a silver cluster leaf, roughly about as thick as this bush willow that's on my right. So poor Shadow, the female leopard, had to dance up a tree like this, where Tingana found himself with the best position in the house. And Tingana sat and watched the hyenas smugly from his perch, and poor Shadow kind of held herself on and waited for them to go away. So Shadow, I think, has probably had, of the three leopards, she's definitely had some of the worst time over the last 2 days. Although I think Karula gives her a very good run for her money. Karula lost her impala kill to Tingana. And for those of you who are new to the show and for whom this is making no sense, it's a long story, but essentially all three of those creatures are leopards. Tingana is a male leopard, Karula is a female leopard, and Shadow is her daughter, her fully grown adult daughter. And we left them moving on to Arethusa. I moved off Arethusa this morning, so I don't know where exactly they went. But it seemed as though Tingana was very much on a mission, so much so that despite Shadow's best efforts, she couldn't seem to attract his attentions. Sorry, everybody, the cough is definitely getting better. That's actually really cool. It's a huge community nest spider web. I don't know if what's going to be better for light. If I do that, is it okay, Jandre? It just looks fascinating. I'm going to hop out and give you a sense of scale. For those of you who don't like spiders, this is perhaps not the spider for you. This is a community nest spider. Most of our regular viewers are familiar with them. But it's fascinating to see the whole setup that they have going on with these massive nests. And I mean, they haven't really gone in for the meat effect, have they? It's just sort of one giant bolus of webbing and leaves and just general debris. And then all around the outside, you know, I'm not sure how well you'll be able to see, but sort of from, oh no, the tree's got me. There we go. All the way from up here, stretched right around, is their catchment web. So essentially geared towards catching any flying insects, like most spider webs. Oh, it's got me now, billowing towards me. And what these little guys do, which is unusual for spiders, because spiders are not really social creatures. In fact, social structures are pretty much an anathema to the spider world. What they do is they send out little hunting parties that will then go and catch whatever prey happens to be in the area or happens to be caught in the web, and they'll bring it back into the community nest itself and feed the community, hence the name. Very sticky. I know that sounds silly, but it's stickier than something like an orb web or a funnel web or anything like that. Okay, just thought I'd stop there because it caught the sun so beautifully. There is, of course, also the fact that the Nkuhuma lions are definitely on Juma. The way that James has described to me where they are, it's going to be exceptionally tricky to get the vehicles in there. So we might wait until it starts to cool down and there's a better chance that they'll pop out and go towards water. And speaking of James, I'm sure that he has plenty to tell you now that he has completed the journey to the Far East, or at least as far east as we can go, and is now on Cheetah Plains.
It's not quite the Far East, everybody, but as Jamie says, as far east as we can go. Now, I may have told you... Oh, my goodness gracious me, that is very violently loud. Oh, sorry. 1 second. Okay. Whew. Now, I may have explained to you that, it is my firm impression that, short of going to a madhouse, you couldn't find a greater collection of lunatics in the world than you have at the camp at Wild Earth. Now, what we have here, of course, is the cure. Brian? Hyena dung has long been used traditionally to cure madness.
How, James?
Well, apparently what you do, but the thing is, you have to have one sane person. So perhaps Amanda is the most sane person. She is our chef, everyone. And what you do is you sort of squash this up and sprinkle it over the food of the mad people whom you wish to cure. And then when they ingest the beautiful white pasty hyena den that looks like a fine meringue. Does look like a nice meringue, doesn't it?
Very tasty.
Then those who are mad will become no mad or not mad any longer.
Wonderful.
Shall we take some back, Brian?
I think we should.
Okay, that is a genuine story. I'm not joking, everybody. Right, on we go. Whew. Calcium carbonate on the end there. Radio's going crazy. This is terrible. Sorry, I'm missing the name there, but the question is, how many or are there any species of bird that migrate between the UK and the Kruger? Absolutely there are. Ah, easy peasy, that's who's asked us the question. easy peasy, yes indeed, there are some birds. I think most of our barn swallows, which resemble of course all the barn swallows you get in the UK, if I'm not mistaken, I think they come from southern France, but anyway, that species of bird occurs here. The humble willow warbler, which you get at home, comes out this way. Your shrike, what we call the red-backed shrike, I think you just call a shrike in the UK, that comes out here. So that's three of them. What else? An osprey. Osprey from the UK might come out here. And then there are lots of shorebirds, and I don't know where things like the common sandpiper and the green shank and the wood sandpiper go. They might go to the UK, but they certainly come out here, and they come from the northern hemisphere, lots long way north. And then of course you get those ridiculously crazy birds, the Arctic and Antarctic terns, that go all the way from pole to pole. But the ones that I've mentioned there I think are probably the most common that come from the UK to here. Thank you for your question, easy peasy. Now, if I'm not far mistaken, those lion cubs were on a road not too far from here. So our idea will be to go down and see if we can find them there. And let's see as we go. The only migrant I've seen back so far is the one you've just seen with Jamie, that's the Wahlberg's eagle. The shrike will come back much later. Everyone is now already listening out for the woodland kingfisher. It was a very late arrival last year, about 16th of November, I think. Somebody very kindly told us the other day. I remember the day it arrived at the Juba Dam Pan, and all the viewers saw it before we did on Game Drive, which made me feel very sad, Brian. I felt very left out. Sorry, I'm just listening quickly. I don't know what that was. We'll try and catch up with it a bit later. Afternoon stations, can I have that update again, please, if it's on cheetah plates? It's on Torchwood. Male lion, not us. Copy, thank you. Hush, ooh. There it is, Brian. It was a southern black tit. There we go. Can you see them there? They're just flying off there. They're just off to the left on that dead fallen. Oh, you've got them. Absolutely brilliant, Brian. The southern black tit. We were asked the other day, what is the smallest bird we get here? It's something called a great penduline tit, but utterly unrelated. Now, just listen carefully. Definitely. There. You hear that? That's a brew brew shrike. Very similar colour to the southern black tit, a pied bird, also known as the telephone bird, Brian, because it goes vrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrr more digital. There it goes. It's flown off. I just saw it flash by, everybody. Now, we're going to keep an eye out on this road very carefully for signs of little lion cubbies. Not sure where the adults were. Ephraim said they went into Mala Mala last night and they did not return. Neglectful gangster parents. They of course have the same fathers, or potentially the same fathers. Sorry, they've potentially had the same fathers as the Nkuhumas. I was just momentarily struck there by a new voice on the radio from Jackie's Sabi camp, or Sabi house. Remember where I showed you the sign yesterday? Somewhere down there. We shall be sure to greet them fondly if we see them. Might be Jackie herself driving. Many ladies on the radio today, which I think is excellent. Cat in Kansas, you're absolutely right. Everybody loves the underdogs. Nobody likes those born with a silver spoon of pride. Everyone likes the underground, the underdog, what shall we say, sort of... I'm trying to think of a bad neighborhood somewhere without being insulting. Can't think of one. I'm just going to leave it there. Bad neighborhood, poor background, neglectful parents, youngsters that then do good for themselves. The Oliver Twists. There we go. The Oliver Twists of the wilderness. That's what we'll call the Styx Cubs. But yes, certainly a great difference between them and the rather silver spoony Nkuhumas. Especially those three little teddy bear things that are so fat. And they look so healthy. I was looking back over a few of the pictures I've taken of them, and they are, you cannot believe, I mean, they really do look like sort of soft toys you might buy from a toy store. High quality toy store. Whereas the Styx Cubs look like they've been put together or made of pipe cleaners. Dirty pipe cleaners. Used pipe cleaners. I'm losing Louise again. I don't know, I'm not entirely sure where they are, so we're just going to wait for Ephraim to get mobile. He will tell us where they were. But I think it was on this road. It's called Rhino Walk Up. And he said they were on the road. But he didn't see them here. We've got a little bit to go before we hit the southern boundary, which is into Mala Mala. Andrea, I'm afraid I didn't hear your question properly. This beastly radio. One second. Try again with that, Weesey, if you don't mind. There we go. Now, hello, Andrea. You say, are the Birmingham boys the fathers of the Styx Cubs? They are. If so, is it possible that they could pass that mange on to other prides? I don't know that it's mange. I think it's quite likely that rather, remember when that Birmingham boy had that skin disease down his belly, that whole thing all covered his belly, and he's now healed completely from it. I think he's given it to them. So yes, I suppose it's possible they could then give it to other lions, but it's unlikely because of course they're territorial. I think that's what's happened here. I don't know that it's mange. Mange is, I think, quite a lot more serious than the skin infection. They could have mange, it's not impossible. If they have mange, then I think, yes, it is possible that they could pass it on through the Birmingham boys, say, to the Nkuhumas. But, as I've said before, I think what you find is the reason they are suffering from the skin diseases because I think they're slightly malnourished. I don't think that they've been fed particularly well. That's not necessarily the fault of the parents. They may have struggled to catch sufficient food, to keep themselves in milk. There seems to have been some kind of vehicle turning around here. And that, of course, will result in any disease that there is in the body taking over. In the same way that we as human beings, you're much more susceptible to disease when you haven't had your vitamins, when you're feeling a bit down, when you're a bit low, and you haven't had sufficient to, we just picked up a friend there, and you haven't had sufficient to eat and your nutritional status is compromised. Alright, well, we're going to do a little bit of a quick loop around here, just see if I haven't missed them. Let's go to find out from Jamie what she got.
So whilst James attempts to track down the lovely Styx cubs, there was a lovely gentleman that we pulled over next to on Buffles Hook Cutline who told us that there are elephants somewhere in this general direction, which is wonderful to hear because there's not much else on Buffles Hook Cutline at the present time. Everything seems to be hiding away from the heat and the dry and keeping us guessing. I mean, there's some impala, but they're sort of roughly in Kenya. There might even have been some that strayed from when James was in the Mara. At this point, they're so far away. Everything is most definitely hiding out. Let's see if we can't figure out where these elephants are that he was talking about. I think he was quite surprised at my expression of glee and surprise when I started cheering at the prospect of Ellie's perhaps... Oh, there we go. Yay! Hello, guys. Thank you, Mr. Construction Man. Awesome. You can hear Ephraim. Oh, James trying to get hold of Ephraim on the Game Drive channel. Hello, elephants. Which way are we going to go? Which way? Maybe girl. Oh, I'm running out of momentum. Oh, hello, girl. Gosh, you got all the way here. That's most impressive. Look who it is. It's our lovely short-trunked Ellie that we started off the sunset safari talking about. And her little calf at the back. Amazing. When I saw them this morning, they were on the southwestern corner of Juma. We're now right at the top. She's in Buffles Hook on our northern boundary with her little one. Check that it's the same elephant, but I need to see her left ear. It's my favorite way of identifying her. You okay there, Jean-André? Just overwhelmed at the excitement of the elephants. The whole Wild Earth crew has come down with the same virus at some point over the last few weeks. There we go. You can see she's got her short trunk. I'm actually going to... Bear with me one moment. I think I'm going to... Oh, it's going to put us right into the sun. I was going to try and turn around. Let me just try to go forward a little bit so we can watch her as she feeds. Hey, girl. She's usually quite lovely and docile. Our short-trunked elephant. We don't want to work on the assumption that it is her. I'm pretty sure it is, though. How's that, Jean-André? You okay there? Perfect. So, Red Red Dog, welcome on board, as always, to the Sunset Safari. Red Red Dog would like to know, well, how do elephants get thorns out of their feet? And the answer is through sort of methodically scraping them against the bottom of the ground. They don't pluck them out with their trunks, as children's stories might have led you to believe. They don't quite have that level of dexterity in this. That being said, a thorn in an elephant's toe or foot is a very rare occurrence indeed. And of course, our short-trunked elephant which is the one that we have here, she would not be able to use her elephant to go plucking out any thorns. I'm so glad we got to see her. But as I said, I've got a really true soft spot for this particular elephant cow. She's obviously got quite the story in her background, however it was that she ended up pretty much without a herd, and then essentially created her own. Hey girl, she's got to do things a bit more delicately, especially with that thorny piece of knob thorn that she's just acquired. But you can see how she's learned to work around her particular physical handicap. She's also got green all over the bottom of her jaw, for those of you who are sharp-eyed. Oh dear. Fear we shall have to move once again, as there is somebody desperately wanting to make their way past. So let me just shift up a little bit. Hi girl, do you mind if I come into... We are going to go on to Buffalo Talk, but only this much. So we won't tell anybody. Just to move out of the way for all 20 cars that have now lined up to get past. I'm exaggerating, it's two. Has he got space there? Yes, should be fine. We don't have the world's best view, but we'll certainly settle here for this one. Just letting that vehicle know who's boss. Don't look at me like that, I didn't do anything. Not me. Sorry, girl. Here we go, relaxed once again. Sorry, girly. Lots of vehicles coming past, huh? But you know it's a main road. Right, guys, unfortunately we're having some serious signal issues at the moment, so we're going to have to leave our lovely little elephant herd for now and start moving back to where we have what's known as Voya telesignal as opposed to Gowrie signal. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush comes with its own complications, so we're going to have to leave our ellies and start moving back towards the dam. Luckily, it does mean that we can go and lurk around the Juma Pan, which is the perfect place to be on a hot afternoon like this afternoon. Bye-bye, girl. Sorry. I'll just move a bit further forward. I don't want to stress her out anymore, so we'll just go up ahead and then we'll turn around ahead there. Hello, girl. So one of my absolute favorite elephants, I've got a soft spot for her. She's got a young female in her herd that we don't know if it's her daughter or if it is a young sister. That's also a possibility. James thinks that she's a little bit too young for it to be her daughter. I'm not 100% convinced, but I definitely see that argument. It might be her younger sister that split away whenever she was separated from her herd. And you could well find that that happened when her trunk was injured in that way. She just couldn't keep up with the rest of the herd, or perhaps they couldn't wait for her. And they moved off and her younger sister stayed. And since then, she's clearly had a male calf who is probably around, I'd guess at about six or so. And she's got a brand new little one that we saw for the first time a couple of months ago, a little female. It's wonderfully cheeky. And I come through, big girl. Sorry for all the interruptions. Yes, you've learned to trumpet at pickup trucks because you know they race away from you. You don't try that with safari vehicles. Elephants are clever creatures. She knows that she could scare them that way. one little straggler making his way to the rest of the herd. And Mitch, while we move away from our elephants and back towards Voyatella's signal, Mitch wants to know whether or not an elephant can hear better from the front or from the behind, or if it doesn't matter. My suggestion is fractionally they can hear better from the front, but it's probably much of a muchness all the way around. And the only reason I'm thinking that is because they don't have quite the same level of directional ability of their ears. So of course Kudu and Inyala, they're able to direct their ears like almost like radar dishes to pick up where the sounds are coming from. Elephants can flap their ears but not really move them to the same degree. So they probably can't hear, but I mean, I'm talking of the smallest of nuances here. There won't be much of a, there'll be a barely perceivable difference, if any. We'll just make sure we look for the lions while we drive along here as well. Keep an eye out for them, since I know they disappeared somewhere off into this really dense vegetation. But it definitely won't be a massive difference, but maybe just a little bit, just because they can, you know how we often do this, Brent's showing you how to listen to things in the bush by cupping your hands around your ears. It works similar with elephant ears. Lion log. In fact, not even lion log, lion soil. Which is even more embarrassing. And one dacre, which disappeared really too fast. Okay. Oh. And we shall race away towards the Voyatella mast. So I'll put our foot flat to race back to Voyatella signal, Oki in Oklahoma, which is, by the way, one of my favorite usernames to say. Oki in Oklahoma had an earthquake this morning and was wondering whether we ever get earthquakes in Juma. But first of all, Oki, I hope that everybody's okay and that it wasn't anything too serious. And the answer is very, very seldom. I've never experienced any earthquakes in the loaf. No, that's not true. There was actually one in Hoedspruit recently. I can't remember what it measured. It was a tiny tremor, but there was one in Hoedspruit. I think it was maybe 4 or 5 or something, somewhere around there. So I'm sorry, I nearly told you something that wasn't true. There was a tremor. But a tremor when?
Under the power lines.
That's so true. We did. Jandre and I actually had a tremor as well when we were sitting with Sandile underneath the power lines. That was terrifying. We don't know if that was the power lines or the earth. Not like the earth though. Anyway, it does happen, but nothing major in this particular spot. Johannesburg occasionally gets slightly more serious incidents, but even then, it's nothing to write home about. And a lot of the time, that's actually old gold mine tunnels collapsing and causing those trembles. So, Oki, I hope that all is well in Oklahoma. I can only imagine, I've never experienced a serious earthquake, but I can only imagine how truly terrifying it must be when it's actually properly serious. Well, things seem to be a bit shaky, you know. We're going to try and get ourselves to a stronger signal region, but for now, unfortunately, please bear with us. We're going to go to Tech Loop, and then we'll see you as soon as we're both sorted and back up and running.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up, and stick with us because you never know what might be on your screen when we return to you. We are back up and running and right next to the Voyatella mast, so hopefully we will be able to keep you entertained within the quarantine area, which is about as far as I will be able to go for now. But we do apologize for that, and we do thank you all for sticking with us. We've got absolutely no idea why, well, I've got absolutely no idea what's going on, but I never do. That's sort of my standard approach. So let's stop and look at these impala instead, because at least I know about those. But thank you to everybody for sticking with us. Was a brief break. We've definitely had worse. Hello, Impala. I don't suppose you've seen our gauri signal anywhere, have you? Yes, no, not so much. You know about as much as I do. In fact, the Impala probably understand a little better what's going on. Accompanied by their cohorts of ox pickers yesterday, no, the day before, or whenever it was, we had one impala that seemed to be playing host to all of the ox picker on Juma, and it appears that this afternoon it is this ewe's turn, and she just suddenly got so irritated with their presence on her. We were chatting today over breakfast, as you do, about the poor lot that is an impala ewe's life. Oh, look at the juvenile, by the way. On the middle of her back, that's a juvenile ox picker. In the center of her back, it's got a black bull rather than a red one. So the two adults, one on the right and one on the left, and then in the center is a juvenile ox picker. Gives us a really nice view of their stiffened... Oh, peekaboo. Look, that one's just starting to get its red eye. Red and yellow surrounded eye. But not yet its red bill. So there you go, the adult sitting on top of the shoulder, and the juvenile looks not totally different, I suppose, but definitely a serious lack of brightness on the face of a juvenile ox picker. And as they comb away through the fur of the impala, it sounds as though James has also had some success with searching for elephants. Let's go and have a look at which ones he's found.
Well, such is my skill, everybody, that I have found signal and elephants at the same place. Brian, are we not amazing?
We are incredible.
Unbelievable.
Unfathomable, some would say.
Indisputable. That doesn't really make sense, does it? No. Anyway, there are some elephants, everyone. We're on the Cheetah Plains driveway, making our way back sort of to within gauri, not gauri, beastly gauri, into Vuyatela. Tower signal range, And suddenly the elephants popped up, and so indeed did our signal. So we'll just watch them here. The most notable thing about what's going on here is how there is no grass on the ground at all, and there is almost nothing in the way of leaves on the trees here. These elephants are on a diet basically largely consisting of bark and dry sticks at the moment, and they ain't looking too fly. Some of them, they're looking a little bit emaciated, really. I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing. I mean, I don't think it's necessarily a train smash for their lives. I think it's probably relatively normal, but they'll certainly be thinner than they would be in a normal year because of the drought that we've had. And we could be staring down the barrel of another month or two without any rain. I don't think it's going to be quite that long.
No, September
20th. Oh, sorry, Brian, the September of the 20th is when we're going to get rain. I think I said the 5th of October or something, didn't I? Or maybe 15th of October.
What, 2017?
No, not 2017, negative. Anyway, they're going to... We can't obviously go off-road here for them because, well, that would be into Chitwa, A. And B, well, we're going to try and avoid going off-road in a drought-stricken place like this. So when they do disappear, we might have to move on slowly. There's another one just up ahead. We're not going to go down, so I'm imagining that if we go forward, we will maintain some kind of signal here. There's quite a large bull here in front of us as we bump along the road. In fact, he's a very large bull with tattered ears. You see that, Brian? He's looking big and tattered. Why he's chosen to show us his bottom, I'm not sure. Anyway, there he is. He's quite a large fellow. He's probably about 10 feet at the shoulder, you know. He's a big guy. But again, doesn't look quite as impressive as he probably does at the back end of a very good summer. Just looking a little bit skinny. Now, the other elephants, of course, that are used to living in conditions like these are the Namibian elephants, sometimes referred to as desert elephants, which, of course, is a slightly incorrect designation. They should be known as desert-adapted elephants, because they managed to cope in the very dry situation that is in Namibia. And these fellows are able, I'm comparing them because the Namibian elephants, those desert-adapted elephants, do look very skinny all the time. They're much slighter than our elephants here. They're exactly the same animal. But it does mean that these elephants can survive in fairly adverse conditions and still be okay. I guess their shape changes, they modify their physiology slightly, and they manage to get by. And again, that lovely colour, perfectly camouflaged for this time of year. And one does wonder why it is that an elephant needs to be camouflaged at all. That's the herd moving up quite quickly towards the north. It's quite a nice picture, that, actually. Going past the bull. And again, very little in the way of birdsong at all. Almost nothing. There's another big bull. That's why they're moving, Brian. Hello, Gail Taylor. Very nice to have you with us. You're in the United Kingdom. You're a first-time viewer, and you say you're addicted already. Well, that's good news. I'm glad you're addicted, Gail. And you want to know about whether or not elephants sleep standing up or lying down. Well, it depends on the elephant. Interestingly, that big bull you're looking at now is quite likely to lie down every so often. He's even bigger than the other chap. He's probably slightly over 10 feet at the shoulder, and certainly a lot heavier. Probably a good 35 to 40-year-old bull. He might lie down, Gail. We do have records of big elephants like that lying down. But normally, sort of between that big size and then down to about a six-year-old, they don't lie down much. Sometimes they lean up against a termite mound. It's quite a good way for them to lie down, but the very little ones do lie down. And Gail, there's a very good reason for that. And the reason is that they, because they're so heavy, they actually crush their own organs, which is quite interesting. They manage to crush their own organs, and so they don't, it's very uncomfortable for them to lie down for too long. And that's why if they are darted and relocated to different areas, you've got to be quite careful about it, because if you lie them down for too long, the blood pools in all the wrong places and they can have really sort of adverse physiological responses to being lain down. So yes, normally it's dozing. And you know, the bigger you are, apparently, the less you actually have to sleep, because your physiology per kilogram is that much slower. Your metabolism per kilogram is that much slower. So you'll probably find that they do quite a lot of dozing in the shade during the day rather than faster sleeping like we do. Thank you, Gail. I hope your addiction continues to take hold of you and that you will spread it to your friends. It's always lovely to have new viewers. I'm just going to sneak forward and see if we can't get a slightly better view of this big bull here. He's a very large fellow indeed. He's also in... Miss Lynn in North Carolina, you're asking me a fairly difficult question. Now, we're going to be a little careful of this fellow. He is in must, which means that his, he'll be a little bit frustrated with life. And so we'll watch him carefully from here. I don't want to pull out straight in front of him. And he is, in fact, coming towards us. So I'm going to give him some space. If he turns too much towards us, I'll just back off down the road a little bit. Oh, yeah, you can't really see it there, but he is a massively impressive fellow. Miss Lynn, you say, if an elephant grows until the day it dies, how much does it weight does it put on every day? Miss Lynn, I couldn't begin to tell you, I'm afraid. You know, a really big bull could be up to 7 tons, I suppose, but that would be massive, massive. The record is about 10 tons. That was an Angolan elephant. This chap, probably about 6. I guess he's about, I'm going to say about 40 years old. In 15 years' time, obviously, they do slow down the growth rate as they get older. I'm going to say when he's, you know, at his pinnacle, of course, he will start to lose weight when he loses his teeth. And he, you know, he can't eat as much, so he'll lose weight then. But Miss Lynn, I'm going to say his growth rate has probably reached a maximum. He'll start slowing down his growth rate, and maybe at his absolute apogee, he'll weigh about 6.5 tons. But I couldn't tell you how much he's going to grow each day. Nice question. I've never thought of it like that. Now, the other bull is talking to him. I can hear the other bull going at him. Much smaller. And this chap's just watching us. He's thinking about what we want. Hello, Paul. You're wondering about water holes in the Kruger, and I have said that they've closed quite a lot of them. You don't understand the logic. Paul, the logic is that when you provide artificial water, you change the species composition of a landscape. The only reason that we have got so many impala here, so few wildebeest, no sable, no eland, no sesame, any of those sorts of antelope, is because we have provided artificial water for all of the animals here. And that means that the zebra and impala have totally outcompeted just about everything else. And Kruger came to realize that very late. And they're now starting to close water holes because of that, and hoping to return the populations of eland and sesame and sable and other animals like that that are not necessarily water dependent or can go, you know, a couple of days between drinks, unlike, for example, impala. So that's the logic behind it. I know it seems slightly counterintuitive during a drought, but remember, a drought is important. It changes things. It means that the elephants open areas up by smashing and killing trees. Now, these two bulls are actually having a conversation with each other. You can see them communicating. The one there, the big chap, is now walking towards the slightly smaller one who's sitting underneath a fairly large fig tree. I'm going to move forward now, just while the must bull is occupied by his friend. He may swing round and just give us a bit of a warning, but I just wanted to get an idea of his amazing size. I mean, he is a monstrous fellow, and he's dripping that green smelly urine at the moment. That's how we can tell he's in must. There we go. There you go, you've got a much better view of him. Now that other bull is not small, but he is dwarfed by this big fellow here. You can see huge, huge ivory. And there you can see the dripping urine of the must bull. Now they say that they can lose up to 100 liters of water a day. Well, exactly, Anna Marie, you say that poor fellow, in must and not a lot of food, he must be quite cranky. Indeed, I would suggest he's very cranky, and certainly he's having a conversation with that elephant in front of him. I know that because they keep turning towards each other. Whether they're actually physically saying anything, I don't know. He's also having a bit of a communication with us. See, he's just turning to us and smelling us now. He's looking, he's turning his head towards us. He's deciding if we're a threat. He's deciding if he's irritated with us or not. Now, at the moment, we're in a perfect position. Were he to sort of turn towards us, we'll just drive all forward. What you don't want to get into is a situation where you have to go backwards, ideally, especially if there is someone behind you, as there is now. So if he starts to sort of cut towards us like this, I'm going to just go a little bit forward because we can't actually escape backwards if we need to. But I think he's fairly preoccupied. Oof, he's really dripping a lot now. And there we can smell it. The sort of sweet leathery smell of an elephant's must. And those two younger elephants, the cow and the calf in front, remember when I said they were moving quite quickly? That's what they were moving for or from. They were trying to get away from this fellow because he'll be looking to mate. And he won't be particularly patient about it. There, you might just, no, you can't quite see them moving off. There, you can see them scuttling off now. Let's carry on. We're being pushed from behind slightly by another vehicle that wants to see the elephants. Now he's watching us. He's turned his head slightly towards us. He's listening, he's smelling, and he's looking. Just want to make sure the guys behind us have got some space to get out the way if he takes the fence. I don't think he's going to. Two vehicles. I think some of them want to go past us. Just going to move off the road. Sorry, everyone. I don't know if they want to get past us or not. And do I say, Brian? Hello, Chai Town Connie. Chai Town Connie, you're wondering about intelligence in elephants and animals generally, and you want to know, do I think that elephants are amongst the most intelligent of species? Chai Town, Connie, it very much depends on your definition of intelligence. And I've been reading quite extensively, actually, on IQ of late. And human intelligence, or the intelligence quotient, Marman, Minjan, how's it? I had heard about them, but we don't have any signal in there. So we're having to go back. Thanks, Mike. Sorry, everybody, that was Mike just telling us about the lions in Cheetah Plains. Unfortunately, we don't have any signal, so we can't go there. Chai Town, Connie, IQ, of course, is basically the measurement of our ability to understand and apply abstract logic. And so in terms of that, human beings, of course, by far more intelligent than anything else. Is a lion able to apply abstract logic? Probably not. Is a lion the most intelligent predator out here in terms of its ability to hunt in a team? Absolutely, unquestionably, that is the case. Is an elephant able to apply abstract logic better than any other animal is? Yes, I believe they probably are. Between them, hyenas, and of course the primates, it would seem that these complex social structures, especially the matriarchal ones, have given some kind of interesting adaptation. The adaptation is that they have this ability to apply a little bit of abstract logic, much more than many other animals can. All right, everybody, Jamie's back up and running. Let's go and get an update from her, and we'll catch up with you later.
We are indeed back up and running and circling the Vuyatela signal area in the hope that we can find something exciting to show you here. How on earth James had Vuyatela signal on Cheetah Plains driveway is anybody's guess, but we are very, very grateful that he did. So I thought, since we're here, we might as well pop down to our pale morph warbird's usual nesting spot, since that should be within Vuyatela signal range, and go and see whether or not they've decided to return home once again, and if indeed it is that particular warbird's eagle. Excuse me. Too much talking. Oh, I wanted to show you this little squirrel. Still there. Can you see it on the left there, Jean-André? Just on the left-hand side of the tree. Well done. Hello, little one. I just want to see why it stopped, what it spotted. Looking intently off in a different direction, but definitely not at us. And when you are squirrel-sized, all kinds of things are a threat to your physical well-being. From Warburg's eagles, for example, to snakes, to slender mongoose, to other squirrels. Which is why they spend a great deal of their time going like little witches' cackles. That is a squirrel's alarm call. Jandre's laughing at me. Was that a good laugh or a bad laugh, Jandre? It was a good laugh. This is so intently focused at everything. Steph, of course, has a squirrel. For those of you who are familiar with the wonderful Steph and Winterboer, or at least Steph's family has a squirrel. It's scary. It once tried to bite me. They've got very, very sharp teeth. So terrifying, Mr. Squirrel. It's completely frozen. Whiskers twitching in the wind. Okay. Relaxing a little bit. Nope. Now just glancing between us and whatever it was that gave it a fright. They are such wonderful little creatures. Enormous eyes. Tells you immediately what this animal relies, what sort of senses this animal relies upon. Oh, bye. That was quick. Ducked behind the marula tree. Okay, let's go to the Warburg's eagle nest and see whether or not we can find them there. One of the most exciting things talking about our different birds of prey species is the fact that this morning I'm relatively certain that Brian and myself found a new shikra nest. In fact, I know we found a shikra nest. The question is whether or not they're going to stay and actually utilize that nest over the next few weeks. But that is really, really exciting. So a shikra is a tiny little goshawk species, roughly sort of yay big, exceptionally small, not quite the Wahlberg's eagle that we're looking for at the moment. But we watched a pair of them breaking off sticks and popping them onto their nest and sort of constructing it all around. It's fascinating to witness. Now, James was wondering about, on the subject of our different raptor species, whether or not our kites are migratory and if we're going to be seeing them back anytime soon. So the most common of the kite species that we get out here is a bird called a yellow-billed kite. And whilst they're not migratory in the same sense of the Wahlberg's eagles, for example, the birds that cover tremendous distances, they do often migrate for food and move further up into Africa and into different parts of South Africa as well. So we should be seeing them relatively soon, returning once again to our shores. My favorite kite, just by the way, is a black-shouldered kite, which I'm going to look up for you in a moment, since our Wahlberg's nest is empty. Yeah, it's empty. There's nothing sitting up there. Sorry. I'm going to just look for the kite species. I'll show you my favorite kite, since all is quiet in Voyatella. How do you spell kite again? There we go. You can hear a squirrel frantically calling, which could well be the Wahlbergs. Or it could be our confused friend from earlier. So James, yes, our kites will be coming back from sort of central and other more northern parts of Africa. That's something for us to look forward to over the next few months. I'm sure that squirrel is shouting at an eagle. Okay. Shift slightly so that we're not quite so at such an awkward angle. I'll show you my particular favorite kite species, which is the black-shouldered kite. Now, this is a bird that I would really love to see. I don't know if you've ever seen them on our live safari drives. Tiny, tiny little kite species. You see them more towards the arid, or at least in my experience, more in the arid areas. But we could get them here. For those of you who are keen bird list builders at Safari Live, have you seen black-shouldered kites? Because I haven't seen one while I've been here, I don't think. Beautiful little bird, also particularly tiny. And I don't know what it is about them that I enjoy so much. This is, by the way, the yellow-billed kite that we so often see. It's the most common of our kite species, much, much double the size of the black-shouldered kite that I was talking about, that James asked the question about. We could also see a black kite, which is the one above it, but that's rarer in this particular area. I haven't seen that many black kites while I've been here. And this is one that migrates on a much further level, so a Palearctic migrant, so much, much further than the yellow-billed oxpecker. So there you go, where's that? There we go, your Palearctic species, so further ranging than the intra-African migrant that is the yellow-billed kite. And very easily identifiable in terms of their shape. They've got a beautiful, almost not quite V-like notch out of their tail. Right, where's Voyatella signals extend to? Just trying to think. I think Ingwe Ali's out. We'll go look at some hornbills eating termites in some elephant dung. That's what we shall do. You okay there, Jandre? Would you like some water? Jandre has also been particularly ill while he was on leave, so we'll both take the opportunity to rehydrate. Very important. You've set me off now as well. It's quite all right. Several sips of water later, Jandre appears to be slightly better off. I'm much better off. Let's have a look at our lovely hornbills sifting through the elephant dung. Actually makes quite a cute picture. Here we go, tucking into the termites. And whatever else they happen to find in there, unlikely to find any dung beetle grubs that might be moving about in that particular dung. They both decided, that's why she's so perfectly symmetrical. Every now and again there's that perfect, I challenge you to get that perfect screenshot with both of them facing opposite directions in perfect symmetry, because every now and again that opportunity is there, and I know how fast some of you are at collecting the screenshots that you do. There will be a perfect moment in here somewhere with their identical bulls. Oh, changed the game a little bit. Shifted that elephant dung ball a little bit off to the left. They are having a field day. Look at them. Let's just count this quickly. One. Oh. Well, now we're down to one. That's not what I meant, though. I meant the number of sort of termites that they must be picking up. Assuming they're picking up one in one go. That's one, two... No, that can't all be termites that they're grabbing one by one. Some of those must be individual, or just shifting them around, or searching through the dirt. Little prehistoric dinosaurs. Off they go. Okay, we're going to do the merry-go-round one more time, since our hornbills have flown off, and go back towards the Wuerteller Dam. If we do it enough time, at some point something very, very exciting will be there. That's just the law of averages. Perhaps the lions will have decided to pop out in the last 5 or so minutes. I'm being very hopeful here, because I can't go any further. And I do just need to chat to poor Taxon, because I ignored him very rudely earlier, and I didn't mean to, but I had to. Taxon. Afternoon, Tex. Sorry about earlier. We were just busy with something. I couldn't chat.
Yeah, no, I have sort of no problem at all.
Copy that. Thank you. No updates from my side. Just Flummy and Law on before the cut line junction, Gari Main.
Okay, good enough. Thanks. Yeah, I just check the Blue Shield Dam. That's the only one go over there. Just went north.
Copy that, thank you. Okay. We're going to send you back over to James, since nothing exciting is happening at Wuerteller Dam. Nothing has changed here in the last 5 minutes since I was last here. Luckily, however, on the subject of things that have changed, James is back up and running. He's made his way back towards Juma, I think. So let's go jump on board and find out what he's up to.
Now, we've been into this area a few times, and there was a pair of pearl-spotted owls, and they flew in between that knobthorn you're looking at now on the left-hand side of your screen, way over the top of our heads, and to another sort of dead-looking knobthorn on the left-hand side there. And we came past here hoping that perhaps they'd be here, but maybe they moved on. I thought maybe they were going to be nesting here as we're heading towards nesting time. Jamie had a wonderful sighting this morning of a shikra, which is a little bird of prey, beautiful little bird of prey with deep maroon eyes, like a sort of fine wine, if you like. And they're that colour, and they were building a little nest not too far from here. But I don't see any of the pearl-spotted owls. Bit further up here. Now, one of the only birds you can con into believing that there's another bird of the same species. The other, of course, Brian, being the grr, your friend, the ground hornbill. That's it. That's the one. Brian has managed to convince ground hornbills to talk back to him. I've never seen anyone else manage that. Okay, let's go again. Here we go. Are you ready?
Lube at the lips.
I can't whistle anymore. I literally cannot whistle anymore. Hang on.
I'll help you out, James.
I can't whistle. Hopeless. Right, let's give that up. That's embarrassing, Brian. I'm sorry about that. I just completely, suddenly lost the ability to whistle at all.
Sorry for the
engineer,
James.
That's quite all right, Brian. I'm very upset. Ah. Now, Mary, you want to know about the yellow-breasted Impalas that we saw today. Yellow-breasted Impalas. And you say we didn't see it, which we didn't. We heard it calling, and it would be a new bird for you. Mary, I'll show you a picture of it first, just for everyone else. I'm sure you've looked it up and you've seen it. But let me show you a picture while we sit here on Treehouse Dam Wall, which of course is not much of a dam at the moment, but that's just prior to the deluge, of course. When the deluge begins, we'll have lots of water in here. Indeed, Brian, it might be a good place for water sports. Skiing.
Wonderful.
Yes, indeed. 360. Here we go, the Impalas yellow-breasted. There it is, everyone. And he's quite a pretty little bird. He's tiny. He's only about, he's about 6 inches tall, a little bit taller than that, maybe 8 inches from tip to tail. That's him there, and he goes, quack, 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 chuck. That's actually a dreadful, dreadful rendition. Crick, 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 sound, sort of. My bird sounds a bit off today. Anyway, they are around, and we could find them in much probably more heavily wooded areas than this. More moisture they like. That's why we saw the drainage line there. We were in that sort of drainage system that extends from the back of Bivelshoek Dam. That's where we saw him today, or heard him today. No sign of Karula coming back, I'm afraid. And obviously we are slightly limited now by our signal, so we're not going to go all the way onto the southern boundary to have a look, but we'll go back around sort of where she had the kill yesterday, see if she hasn't come back to reminisce over that quite astonishing 5-leopard sighting we had yesterday. I don't think they're ever in picture all together at the same time, but there were five leopards in one place. And if you weren't watching, it was Shongile and Hosana, Shadow, Karula and Tingana. That is five, is it not? Yes, it is. Yes, good. But I don't think they were ever in picture at the same time, but they were definitely all around there. Then the hyenas pitched up, and then the most magnificent animals, the wolves of Juma, the African wild dogs. I'm really sad that they didn't bother to hang around for the rest of the day. You all right there, Brian? Swallowed a fly, did you? Yes. Brian swallowed a fly, everybody.
It was quite tasty.
Was it? Did you chew?
A little bit.
Oh, disgusting. Utterly disgusting. Don't ever eat a fly, anybody. Especially our younger viewers. Flies are not good for you. Sometimes they do fly into your mouth, though. It's not very nice. We'll just watch the road here and see if we can't find any sign of either the dogs or the hyenas. And we went to check all the hyena dens this morning. Nothing. Lots of tracks heading into Bivelshoek, around about sort of sandy patch which is near the Sydney's Dam. but unfortunately we didn't manage to find any actual hyenas. I was just hit on the head by a tree. Did you see that, Brian? It's very unfair. We're going to see if we can go left down here, and we'll see if we can maintain signal while we go down here. I think Jamie's going to go and do some filming. I don't know if she started yet. She has to go and do some stuff for National Geographic. So you might be stuck with me for the foreseeable future, everybody. Sorry about that. So it goes. Here we go. Tom. I'm listening. Yes. Tom in Dallas has worked out in a very complicated fashion. I'm not going to try and go through it while we're live here. That an elephant, allowing for rapid phase of growth until 15 and then peaking at around about sort of 50 years or 45 years maybe, he reckons that a 6.5-ton elephant bull is growing between a fifth and a tenth, is that right, of a kilogram every day. Thank you for that very much, Tom. Very good mathematics there. Excellent. Thank you very much. I'd love to see the graph that you put that on. Brilliant. Thank you. Now, we have an interesting array of birds here, and there is a nest there. Now, you can hear the bzz, bzz, bzz of the rattling cisticola. It's flown off, but what there was in there was a chagra. A black-crowned chagra went in there, and there is a nest. I don't know if that is actually a chagra's nest, but I don't want to go and disturb it if it is. So it could be. This is a very productive nest spot. I've seen a cisticola's nest. They build them on the ground, believe it or not, just under the base of a bush. Oh, there he is. Well spotted, Brian. There is the chagra. Very nice. And just flying overhead, you might be able to just pick up the sound of the white-crested helmet shrike going tick, 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 tick. It's a brown-crowned chagra, everyone. You can see it's brown-crowned, Brian, because it has a
brown crown.
A brown crown. Well done, well done. You can see a member of the shrike family, maybe, from the fact that it has that toothed bill. Here we are. And I'm just going to look, while you're watching him, let's just have a look and see which kind of a nest he makes. Lucia, you're wondering while we watch the brown crown chagra if the drought is the reason I cannot whistle anymore. No, because I was whistling fine recently, Lucia. I think it's just that I got nervous.
Stage fright.
I got stage fright. It's a horrible thing, stage fright, Lucia. I'll try again shortly. Shallow cup nest placed in a tree or shrub. It could well be that that is the nest of the brown-crowned chagra.
Yes. Well done, James. Well done.
Yay! Lucia, I'm back. Awesome. That you heard there, they're the white-crested helmet shrikes. What you heard there was a fork-tailed drongo that was trying to mimic the pearl-spotted owl much more poorly than I did it, of course. They're such pretty birds, these. There they go in their little flock. They too will be looking for a nesting site. And they breed as a flock. And just on the ground there, Brian, this is an extremely productive little spot here, is a dwarf mongoose. There he is, scuttling into the undergrowth.
interested.
Oh, there are a few of them. They're at the bay. There we go. And he's looking for scorpions. Bless you.
Oh, thank you.
Bless you. He's looking for scorpions and eggs and grasshoppers and, well, I suppose he'd eat a nestling bird if he could catch it. Maybe even the odd small snake. I've always struck at how human their ears are. Isn't that lovely? Just like human ears. Right, stand by everybody. Hold on, remove your dentures, put your clothes, well not your clothes, your drinks. I don't know why I said that. Put your drinks down. Put your drinks down. Put your jerseys on, perhaps. There's a leopard at the Juma Dam cam. Put your clothes on. We're going off to the Juma Dam cam. There's a leopard there. Hold on. We can't go to Jamie. She's filming stuff. So you're going to have to come with us. There's a wind blowing. And if you want to see it, go to the Juma Dam camera. And you can see it. Who is it, Louise? We'll try and find out who it is for you. Oh, we don't have a visual of it, unfortunately. For some reason, the camera at this feed is not going into the final control at the moment. So thank you, viewers who are tweeting. Please tell us who it is. Hashtag Safarilive, question at wildearth.tv. And most of all, tell us where it goes. I'm just going to call on the radio and see if anyone's close by there. Any station near Jumapan? There's apparently a leopard at the Jumapan on the camera. We have no visual of it at the moment. I'm going there. I'm about 2 minutes out. Oh, thank you very much. A pixelated green screenshot has come through. I'm not sure who it is, or male or female. There's a leopard at the Jumapan that's on the camera. I will be there in 2 minutes. If you're close by, please go ahead. All right, there are a few people coming in. Well, Tax is not too far. He's going to come in and help us. Thank you for the screenshot that came through. Can't identify it just yet. Can't see if it's male or female. All right, definitely a female. Thank you. Well done. You're still there, Brian?
Still here.
Are your clothes on?
It's all gone.
Oh, God. It's a relief. Watch out, Cape Spurfowl. Still drinking, everybody. Still drinking, what a joy. Come on, Rusty. Up we go, over, second gear. Third gear. You like my racing change there? It's very, Hamilton-esque. Right, we are now 20 seconds. Hold on. Right, we're nearly there, just down here. Right, still drinking. Herbert can see it. Don't know where Herbert is. Right, here we go. Big stick there. Can you see a leopard, Brian? Are you still there? Clothes still on? Excellent. I see the leopard. Hurrah! There she is. Hello. Oh, she's very skittish. Very skittish leopard. Look at her running. We are a long way from her, everybody. This animal is very unrelaxed. Has gone down into the dam. We'll try. I think she might cross onto the dam wall. This is fascinating. Isn't that amazing? I'm just going to go around here. See if we don't catch her coming up and over the wall. Can you see her? Shall I stop here, Brian? No, there she is. Yeah, I affirm, but she's very unrelaxed, Tech. She's running, and I'm about 100 meters from her. She's looking at us, everybody. No idea, I'm afraid. Tax is just asking which one it is. I've got no idea. There she goes. There she goes. You hear the squirrel's alarm calling. And please do send us your screenshots, everybody, because this will be fascinating. That's going to be the best way for us to be able to identify her. There, she's going up onto the wall now. You see her there, Brian? Shall I just sneak forward? We don't want to get any closer, we just, there we go. She's out in the open now. Isn't that amazing? A brand new leopard. Oh wow, wonder who she is. I'm sure she's the same one whose tracks we had the other day, or this morning actually, on Aubrey's Road. Try and get some screenshots, everybody. That's as tight in as we can get, I'm afraid. And the best thing to do is just give her some space and time. That might be the last we see of her. Let's just go around the corner. Oh, that's very special, everyone, to see a leopard we haven't seen before. Now, I know it's very tempting to go quite quickly up so that we can see down, but I think we will freak her out if we do that, so we're going to move very slowly, keep the engine just ticking very slowly over. We might see her pop out there in the lee of the spillway. There she is. You got her, Brian? I wonder who on earth that is. Look at the spots moving there. Let's carry on. Thankfully, Rusty's not doing her over-revving trick right now. She's gone down into the drainage here. She ran from about 150 meters, everybody. This is almost 500 feet. She decided we were much too terrifying. Which means she's just not used to vehicles. So from whence has she come, Brian? One doesn't know. You see her. Got her. So the research at the moment is indicating that this is Nchila, a granddaughter of Saleyesha, daughter of Msele. Oh, you know what, Ayan, I think I may have seen a picture of her before. She's got a very fluffy tail. And that's why she's called Nchela, I think. This is very cool, everybody. It's so nice that we've actually got a view of her. Right at the end of the lens. We'll just go a little bit forward and we'll maybe catch her coming out the other side. It's always very tempting to move fast, but the trick, of course, I think with these leopards is to move as slowly as possible with as little fuss and noise as possible. Now she might pop off down there. She might turn south inside that thicket, though. You got anything there, Brian? That might be it, everyone. But she also might cross over up onto the road. She certainly looks like she was looking for a drink. And when they're looking for a drink like that, it's quite often that they've got a kill nearby. But if this is a territorial female leopard, Louise, any idea how old she is? If this is a territorial leopardess, she's way out of her territory. This is firmly in the territory of the Great Queen herself. Shall we go up onto the road there, Brian? So Feb 2014, she's 2.5 years old, so she'll be looking to sort of try and take a territory. Well, no, she's still too young to be territorial in a busy leopard area. And she's not next to her mother's territory at the moment, you see. Let's just ease our way slowly up here. It's very tempting to drive a bit quicker than this, but we're not going to. Yes, Rose, you're absolutely correct. You say you think she might be the daughter of Anderson. She is. If this is Nchela, she is the daughter of the Anderson male and Nsele. You say that might account for a large size. She's not big. She's not a big female. She's pretty average sized. But I mean, she's only 2.5 and she looks like an adult, so she will get slightly bigger. Not much bigger, but slightly bigger. Shout if you see her, Brian. Oh, there she is. She's straight in front of us there. Unbelievable the speed of this man on the camera. It really is quite astounding. You still see her?
Yeah.
There we go. There she is. You just see her moving through the bushes there. She might come out into the open in front of us if we sit very still. Let's just wait here. Not sure how much further we're going to be able to go down this road before we lose signal, but I think it's worth probably just easing our way down. Now, as with all of these animals, and Brent did an amazing job with Gijima not too long ago, that skittish, I can see her. You see where the bird just flew up? She's just behind that. You've got to be so careful about getting too close, and you've just got to let them get used to you, and they do. Then they habituate quite happily. You can hear the squirrel alarm calling. Squirrel's seen her. I'm just going to look in there. I'm not sure if I can or can't see her there. You hear the squirrels, everybody? I can't see her in there, can you, Brian?
No.
Let's ease forward again. I just saw a little bit of movement around about where Brian was showing you.
There she is.
You got her. Gonna stop?
Yeah. There she is.
Oh my goodness. Brian, that is awesome. I can't actually see her. Yes, I can. Gen B, what a very, very brilliant thought. You're absolutely correct. You say, could she be looking for a consort? Definitely, at 2.5 years old, she'd be ready to have her first youngster. Maybe that's exactly what's going on, Gen B. Brilliant thought. She'll be looking for Tingana, who I don't suppose, given the time he's had with Shadow of late, would be too happy to see her, but absolutely. That definitely inspires leopards to go out of their territories. Females will always go out of their territories to go and look for mates. I mean, it's actually such a good thought that I'm deeply ashamed I didn't think of it myself. Ryan, is that as close in as we can get?
I can go closer.
Can you just try a little closer? I just want to try and get a spot pattern because I actually can't see her. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So she's a 4-5 female. That's interesting. Would everybody agree with that? Please, if you think I'm wrong, take a screenshot and let's count them because I just got a brief view there. I would have said 4 on our left, her right, 5 on her right, our left. And that is distinctive and it's unusual. You could see those spots, and in case you're wondering what I'm talking about, you see the nose? Just under the nose, of course, you've got the whiskers, but between the nose and the whiskers, you've got a line of spots. And that's quite a good way of identifying them. And she's got very marked, pronounced spots there. There, you've got 4. Small one in front, 3 behind that. It might even be considered another one behind that one. She's quite dark. Her spots are very close together. Go ahead, Herbie. And now Herbert has got a female lion going towards the pan. Copy, thank you, Herb. So the cubs might go towards the pan, but we're not going to move. We're going to stay with this leopard for now. Now I'm just going to warn Taxon because I think he's going to come along this road. Stations, we have got long distance visual of this young female. So if you're coming along Central Road towards Gowrie Dam, just let me know and I'll keep you posted. Okay, copy that. I'm with a young female leopard just on Central, just the other side of the dam. Long distance visual, very skittish. Oh, this is wonderful. Isn't this special? It's so special. So, please let me know. Hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. How many spots do you agree with my assessment? 4-5? And if so, do we know what Nchela's spot pattern is supposed to be? Hello, Ellen Fowler, thank you very much. You say you do agree 4-5. Well, if you agree, then I must be true. Our resident leopard expert. So 4-5, spot pattern. Very pink nose, that's distinctive. Doesn't change often with leopards. They often stay the same color. I'm just going to have to get on the radio here. Go ahead. I said go ahead. Confirm you want to make your way here. You're talking to James? Sorry, everybody. We're on Central, just south of Gowrie Dam. Animal is skittish, so if you approach, you can approach from the Gowrie Dam side. Just approach very slowly. This is wonderful. Okay, copy, thank you. Okay, everybody, if you want to see the lioness that is drinking at the pan, you can go to the dam cam and have a look. It's only her. There are no cubs there at the moment. So we're going to stay with this leopard and just let her calm down in front of us. Now, I think this is a different color kind of leopard. So we've got the Karula and her kin, Tandi and shadow, of course. They're quite pale, honey-coloured leopards. Then you've got the offspring of the old Campbell Coppies female in Inkanyeni, who's very gold. This leopard, to me, looks dark. She's got a kind of almost brownish hue to her fur, and her spots look to me to be quite close together. Quite distinctive. I mean, I think that's quite a good way, and I might just be making nonsense here, but I think it's quite a good way of telling that she's not closely related to a Karula, for example. I've never seen Salayesha. Does Salayesha look the same? There's some elephants just to the side of us. We'll just quickly have a look at them and show you that they are around here. This is wonderful. We'll just sit right here. We don't need the Gowri repeater or the cheetah plains at the moment. Lion at the pan, elephants walking to the left, brand new leopard on the right, squirrels alarm calling because they can see her. Yeah, Paul, that's exactly correct. You say, was she not used to vehicles? She appears to be on edge. Paul, she's absolutely on edge. And that's because she isn't used to vehicles. They do get used to vehicles, and it doesn't take... I'm surprised she isn't, because, of course, her grandmother is the bulk of the Simbambili and Elephant Plains leopard viewing. I have never seen her mother in Sela, but I imagine that she's probably quite relaxed, and they normally take a cue from their mothers. I'm just going to tell Tex, because he wants to try and come here. Tex, what's your position? Yeah, it might be. She's static at the moment, Tex. We're watching her from about 40 meters. She's static at the moment in a thicket. Might be worthwhile. There's also a lioness at the pan and a breeding herd of elephants making its way to the Juma pan. So certainly worth your while coming up here. I'm just helping him to come decide whether to come or not. Now I'm going to try and take a picture of her, Brian, except I can't actually see her with my naked eye. There she is. You think my camera can focus on her? Absolutely not. Oh dear, there's no card in the camera. It's like having no film, Brian. Disaster. I think she's rather splendid. Anybody else agree with me that she's a bit darker? Do you think she's darker, Brian?
I do.
Feel free to weigh in on the discussion.
I do agree with you, John.
Oh good, thank goodness. The world's slowest wildlife photographer will attempt a photograph. There we are. I have some spots in the thicket. Very nice. Are you happy with this position, Brian? Shall we try and go back very slightly?
Backwards would be good.
I'm going to just start the engine and go backwards very slightly, everybody. See what she does. So don't just pretend not to look at her. Just shut your eyes as I start the engine. This is the inevitable part of habituating in a leopard like this. She might move away, but that's, you know, it's part of habituating. We're just going to go back like that and stop, right? Lucia, very good question. You say, could she be on edge because this is not her territory? Yes, to a certain extent, but not from us, you know. This, I actually didn't finish answering the question about why she'd be skittish. I can only think that what's happened since she became independent is that she has not been around vehicles, because she probably lives on Biffle's Hook and goes into the southern parts of the Manuleti. It's entirely possible that she is skittish because she just doesn't see vehicles very often, and so from the time she went independent, she just hasn't seen many other cars. But yes, I suppose the fact that she is in another leopard's territory could make her nervous, but not of us. She's wonderful. Well, I mean, she's a leopard. Of course, she's wonderful. I've yet to meet a leopard I haven't thought was very wonderful. Her ears listening, twitching all the time. The squirrels watching her, shouting at her. And the elephants utterly oblivious as they walk past the left-hand side of us. About 30 elephants have just walked past us, everybody. Maybe not 30, maybe 20. She's definitely rather splendid. Now, if you could just look this way, I'd like to take a picture of your face, madam, so that we might have a reference. Well, all of you have taken screenshots of her face, of course, so we can use those as a reference, and thank you very much for them. And nobody else has tried to come to the sighting, which is quite nice. But they might try and come in just now, which is good. It's not a bad idea. Hello, Charlie. You say, who did I say her mother was? You thought I said Salayesha to start with. And then someone else. I did. Her mother is Nsele. Her grandmother is Salayesha. Oh, there we are. She's looking at us now. Oh, you are a very pretty thing, obviously. I'm falling into that trap, of course, the ultimate human trap. When we see a female animal of any sort, we say she's pretty. As opposed to when we see a male animal of any sort, we say, ooh, he's so big and strong. Louise says she says Sandile is pretty all the time. Good for you, Louise. You are not hampered by the conventions that I have been hampered by. Bit difficult. Louise is now trying to convince me that the millennials are not constrained by such narrow-mindedness. I'm going to leave it till I get to camp to answer that question for her. I'm not sure I'd describe Tingana as pretty. Louise, would you describe Tingana as pretty? Tingana, apparently, according to Louise, is not pretty. Brian, he is a?
A beefcake.
A beefcake, indeed. She thinks that's ridiculous, you see. Come across the dam, Tax, and then you'll see my car on the road here. Just come very slowly. I think she'll sit for you. So just keep coming. She's about maybe 40 meters off the road in the thicket. Mary, you say she's so distinctive it almost looks like she's got a backward S on her forehead. Yeah, I don't know if it's just the way my mind works, but I struggle to see some of the spot patterns that many of you do, and I'm not for one second saying you don't see them. Absolutely you do, because your identification of these animals, the hyenas especially, I think that's the most impressive thing, but it's almost invariably accurate. For me, it's the spot patterns and the nose are the only things I'm able to really use. unless it's something really obvious like the wow on the front of Karula. And Brian, I'm just going to ask you to slip the camera to the left slightly for the 5-ton elephant bull heading this way. Da. I don't really want to move, so we're just going to see if he... She's now gone to sleep, everyone, so don't worry about that. I'm watching her. I'm watching him too, in case he tries to remove Brian from the back of the car, but I don't think he's going to do that. Isn't he wonderful? He's just kind of given us a bit of a look, and now he's carrying on. And that was a little bit of flatulence as he went by. Thank you very much, Mr. Elephant Bull. Gracie, aged 9, you say, don't I wish we could understand elephant talk? Absolutely, I wish we could. Gracie, I think we'd learn so much from elephants. I think we'd have great fun if we could A, understand them, and B, talk to them. Let's go back to the leopard, which is now fast asleep over there. Right, we're going to try and bring Taxon into the sighting, so we'll just get a nice focus on her and see what she does. Now, Taxi, just move straight in here. Now, Taxon, of course, is now hampered by his ability to move in here because there is a 5-ton elephant in his way. That is not showing any signs of getting out of the way. There it goes. It's just moving slightly off. And the lioness apparently is moving across the dam wall towards the Gari cut line. I think being followed by, I did see a vehicle following him. Okay, I think she's going to sit tight. Tax, come in as close as you can to the back of me. And let's see what she does when the new vehicle comes in. Yeah, she's lifting her head. She'll probably look around. Hey Von. Hey, it's so many lingof. We must have spoken yesterday. Just telling Tex. She hasn't moved. Now I look like a complete idiot because I've said she's unrelaxed. Go ahead, Sally. Yeah, absolutely. Tax just pulled up and she didn't even lift her head, so yeah, go for it. And the lioness has just been spotted by the in the vehicle. We just Brian's just looking to see if we can spot her too. The leopard now totally unconcerned, so I look like a complete moron. I'm told everybody so skittish, probably not worth your while coming here. Yeah, Shamel, you say maybe she's skittish due to the lions nearby. Yeah, that's possible. It's definitely possible. I don't know where she's come from. I'm pretty sure these were the tracks. Hers must have been the tracks that Jamie saw. The other thing is, you know, she's now in a thicket, and a leopard doesn't like to be caught out in the open. And we did catch her out in the open a bit, drinking. Very vulnerable. All animals feel very vulnerable when they're in the open and they're drinking. And so maybe that's just what made her a bit nervous. But it definitely, it could be the presence of lions. I just think her tracks come from a different spot from where the lions are. Ah. Now there's a wonderful insight coming from... Wonderful insight coming from... Tristan in Simbambili. Tristan says that it could be, it looks like Nchela, but also Nchela had a sister that was much more unrelaxed, and they were both viewed as cubs, and that the sister was that much more unrelaxed. So maybe it's the sister? I don't know. Whatever the case, she's now much more relaxed than she was when we started, which is great. I can't believe we're having the sighting. I'm really amazed. Well, let's see if we can get hold of Tristan again and ask him if he knows what the spot pattern of Ancella's sister was. She's got quite a distinctive scar across the front of her nose as well, which you can't quite see where you're sitting. Just keep an eye out for that lion. I think she's headed off to the north. And in the background, I'm not going to ask Brian to give us the call, because that will definitely frighten the leopard, but the hardy-dar ibis making its Saturday afternoon presence felt. Don't do it, Brian. You'll frighten the leopard. Will be frightened, terrified. Hardy-dar ibis is a bird, everyone, with a very long beak. I'm now double whispering, of course, because although I don't want the leopard to run away, I also don't want her to disturb the other people around here watching the sighting. Yeah, she's much darker than I think any other leopard I've ever seen. And it's not just that her rosettes and spots seem very close together. It's that her fur in between them is brown. It's not honey-coloured like Karula's or golden like Nkanyeni's. Thank you once again to those of you who managed to point out and kept your eyes on the dam cam. And Tristan's now going to hopefully give us the spot pattern of both of them, Nchila and... Oh, she's sleepy now. Brilliant. Well, everyone, the only kind of... negative of this is that she's really smack bang in the middle of Karula's territory, which means she ain't going to be around here for long. But as Jen B said, she could well be looking for a consort. She's going to be a little bit jealous at the moment, of course, because Tingana is with Shadow on Arethusa. But what is interesting is that I have seen, and it is not uncommon, for two female leopards in Estrus to be with one male, both demanding his attentions and indeed receiving his attentions. So that's not too uncommon. That would be quite a sight for us to see here. Now, I mean, she's completely relaxed now. I don't know what she'd do if we tried to go closer. I don't think we're going to. It's all hard. Very skittish she was to start with. Sun's starting to sink now. Little wind blowing in from the northeast. And as the seasons have changed, so that wind has changed from being a northwester or a southeaster to a little almost offshore northeaster. Always get that wrong. Don't know why it is that I cannot pick my east from my west when I wish to. And it's quite nice that people are talking on the backs of the cars here and having a little laugh, because the more used to the human voice she gets, the more likely she will be to relax completely around people. Like I say, I mean, if you just pulled into the sighting, you'd say I was mad. Now, apparently, Ria, you are asking whether Brent saw this leopard a few weeks ago, and Jerry is confirming, despite the fact that she's wearing a giraffe suit onesie in the final control. Yes, that is true, if you've just joined us. Brent apparently has seen this leopard before, so you've definitely seen her. And she was seen on Arethusa, which makes sense. So, if she is who we think she is, or the sister of who we think she is, she's coming into the time when, yes, she might be thinking about mating now, and she'll be trying to eke out a territory next to her mother's. But of course her grandmother is still alive, and they are slightly hamstrung or prevented from expanding to the north by the Manileti fence. So she might go into Manileti, which means she won't find a huge number of vehicles. Could explain her slight skittishness. But she's also sandwiched between Karula to the east of where she was born, Shadow to the south, her grandmother to the far west, the grand old dam of the west, Salayeshe. And thankfully for her, and her sister no doubt, Salayeshe's current cub I think is a male if I'm not mistaken. And that means he must move away, he won't set up a territory next to his mother's. So I think if no one minds, I think we'll probably just sit with her and see what she does. And we can go and try and find something else, but given the fact that we have dodgy signal this afternoon, I think it's probably worthwhile just sitting and watching and seeing what she does. Look how black the top of her head is. Well, great question, Bud, in North Carolina, you say. What are the chances of seeing 6 leopards in one day like this? Very small, Bud. Highly unusual. Very unusual. And what an amazing thing it was. I mean, the record that I know of is 9. 9 in one sighting. I'm not sure exactly what the makeup was. Well, that was in one sighting. We saw 5 in one sighting today. And a 6th just knocking about. Yesterday, sorry. Sorry, Louise. Stern correction there coming out of the final control. Whew. Yeah, she's chilling out now. I mean, this, as they say, ain't her first rodeo. But it's not, she's not the most experienced rodeo rider. Which means she's just a little weary. It's also getting darker, she's in some much thicker bush. So I think she's pretty happy now. Hello, René in Wisconsin. You're wondering whether leopards feel more relaxed sleeping in a tree than on the ground. René, to some extent, yes, and sometimes you see leopards sleeping in trees almost for safety so that they can relax. They're not very comfortable up there, you know. I think they'll actually possibly worry about falling out if they fall asleep completely. And very seldom do you see them soundly sleeping in a tree for any length of time. Karula does it, actually. But very few other leopards that I've known actually go and rest in a tree as opposed to rest on the ground like this. It's much more comfortable for them to lie on their sides like she's doing, as opposed to sort of draped over a tree. And I've tried to drape myself over a tree, and it's not comfortable. Everything kind of is in the wrong place. There's spiky bits that stick into you. So, yeah. And Tax is just moving a bit now. He's trying to get a better view, which is a good idea. Let's see what she does. She's up. Well, her head's up. Ah, now Raisa, thank you very much, all the way from Finland. That's astounding. And Sele's other cub had a 3-4 spot pattern. This is definitely then must be in Chela. because that is an ain't no 3-4 spot pattern. That looks very 4-5 to me. So, yeah, I'm going to go with Ancella. We might try a slightly closer approach, just as the sun has peeped down below the horizon. Andrew, good question, and yes, you're absolutely correct. There's the sun going down. You say, would Karula be more aggressive towards a female who was not related to her? Absolutely she would. She would not tolerate the presence of this leopard in her territory. She'd be very cross. I mean, I say that, but, you know, you saw that Shadow had quite a nasty wound on her today, and we don't really know why that happened or who gave it to her. It's unlikely Tingana gave it to her. So the only other thought is that Karula chased her off. So I don't know how she got that wound, but in theory, the textbooks will tell you that she would be in far greater danger from Karula than, say, Shadow or any other related leopard. I'm not going to put a light on her, everybody, so once the sun goes down and it gets a bit dark, we'll carry on and see what else we can see. And like I say, we are very limited by the space in which we can move today. She is now chilled to the max. Hello, Bud, in North Carolina. You want to know the spelling of this leopard's name? The spelling we have is N-C-H-I-L-A. And yeah, in Chile, I guess that could be right. Normally the C-H sound, if it is a Shangaan word, is T-S-H. Right, let's go with N-C-H-I-L-A. Now there are some lions just around the corner here. So what we're going to do is try a very slightly closer approach here and see what we can find. Are you ready, Brian?
I'm ready.
I think keep the camera on her and let's see. This is not too bad, is it, Brian? I wonder what she was so skittled by. Ooh, that's quite nice. How's that? She's got very pretty eyes. But you can see she's watching us, and there you can definitely see the fall. Oh. That is a really nice shot, Brian.
Try and take a photo.
I'm going to take an amazing photo, Brian. It's got a stick in front of it there. Very irritating. Here we go. Open your eyes, little Enchila. Oh, listen to the bearded woodpecker there making his final tapping noise of the day. Ellen in Arkansas, you're wondering if she would... if Karula's offspring would be competition for her in this area. Definitely, But Korea doesn't have any female offspring that are not territorial other than young Shongile. Shongile won't be trying to take a territory for the next at least a year, normally. So, no, there wouldn't be a Karula offspring that she'd compete with at the moment. Yeah, I'll just come along Central Road. Animal is still static. And so, you know, Karula's latest offspring, but before these two were two males, they've kind of headed off into the ether, which is what male leopards do, quarantine sometimes around this area, but he would have no effect on female territoriality in the area. So no, there are no female Karula offspring that are not territorial already, and therefore she wouldn't really be squeezed in this particular area by a Karula offspring. That said, these territories do shift around a bit. We have seen Shadow this far north, we've seen Tundi this far north, but I think they're just incurring into their mother's territory. I think this leopard, as Jen B said, quite could well be coming into estrus and seeking out a mate. Splendid, Brian, splendid. Hello, Aqua. You say thank you for staying with this leopard so that we could get an ID. Aqua, believe me, it has not been a trial in the slightest. I've had a thoroughly good time sitting with a brand new leopard, even though she ain't been doing a whole lot. It's been lovely to be with her. Thank you for watching and sending us through your comment. The vehicle just moving in. Ahí. Ecomiza. Has lifted her head slightly to have a look at the new arrivals. They're quite blue eyes, those, aren't they? When they're open. When she bothers to open her eyes. I can't believe that original sighting of her hairing off across the damn wall has resulted in this. Oh, now, nice comment from Tristan at Simbambili, who says that this is definitely in Chile. Thank you for that, Tristan. You say that Tiani Salayesha's current cub is, in fact, a female. And that radio broadcast you heard was Tax just saying that he can hear the lion cubs in the drainage line where we went to try and find them today, or where we lost them when they disappeared in there. She's got a bit of a itch on the end of her nose. Very tired. Brian, don't fall asleep. It can be very soporific to watch a leopardess closing her eyes, or a lion falling asleep. You get a sympathy nod off. You can see, just like all leopards, when they sleep, they drop off like this, and then they wake up again. As soon as a sort of sound touches their ears, or a slightly strange smell touches their nostrils, they wake up and look. Cannot afford to sleep completely soundly, and I mean, nothing else could have shown that better than the wild dogs yesterday, which completely changed the situation. No one expected them to come in. She was given a fright there by a black-crowned chagra that just flew out behind her. Faith Ann, you're a new viewer. It's lovely to have you with us. Thank you for A, watching, and B, taking the time to send us a question. You say, how do you choose the leopards' names? Well, this is a source of great conflict in these areas, Faith Ann. Not for the leopards, they couldn't care less. But can you see the bird behind her there? It's shouting at her, it's on the ground. Ooh, there she goes. Faith Ann, normally what happens is, when they're found, on whosever property they farm, the rangers or the senior rangers there will decide on the name. So, for example, Shongile and Hosana, who are the two offspring of the leopard we see the most, that's Karula, the queen of Juma, they were named by Taxon and Aubrey, who are the senior rangers on Juma, and that's because the two little cubs were born on Juma. Now, in this case, I'm not sure where, I think probably on Simbambili, Tristan will be able to tell us. I suspect they were born on Simbambili, and that's where they got their names. But often there's quite a lot of conflict over the naming of leopards, which I find rather amusing. I can't bring myself to become too passionate about it, because they really don't care. If you go down south of the Sabi Sand, she at the moment would probably be known as the 4-5 female or 4-5 young female, and that's because they don't tend to give them names like we do up here in the north. And the idea there is that it keeps them more wild. It gives the impression that they're more wild. In actual fact, all that happens is that people then start calling them sort of, should be known as 4-5 or 4E or 4-5E or something like that, in which case it really doesn't make any difference at all. Mind warp, hello mind, hello mind warp. You say, do I know if anyone has moved into the territory of Kwatile? Now, Kwatile, a recently deceased leopard, we think killed by a snake, perhaps, and it lived sort of south of Arethusa and into the northern parts of Londolozi. And you want to know if anyone's taken over her territory. I think what's happening here, there is a leopardess who has moved north towards her territory. I also think that her death has resulted in us seeing much less of Shadow. I think Shadow has moved further south, and the leopard to the south of Kwatile's territory has moved north. And I think that's one of the reasons we're seeing much less of Shadow at the moment, because I think she has taken up residence in the northern parts of Kwatile's territory, which makes perfect sense, given that Karula, too, seems to have moved slightly further south. She doesn't spend much time up towards... She generally comes up into this area here, halfway through Juma. Sometimes she goes into Bufalsuk to the north of us, but normally she has been concentrating quite a long way to the south of us. And I think that all of that movement is probably largely a result of the demise of the hapless Kwatile. You can just feel the night changing now. You can see the sun has gone down. The birds are calling their last. There's the whirring of the white-browed scrub robin. There's a Cape glossy starling. There you can hear it. We heard the bearded woodpecker making his last territorial. One or two doves having a spat before they go to sleep to roost. Birchall starling way in the distance. And of course we did hear the hardy-dar ibis earlier. Thank you, Brian. Thank you for doing it in a subdued fashion so that the leopard did not get up in disgust and run away. So as you can see, everybody, my original interpretation of this leopard's behavior, completely accurate. She's absolutely terrified of us, really doesn't know what to do with herself. I'm going completely sarcastic now. She is fast asleep, completely relaxed. Whether she'd be so if we walked or drove next to her, I don't know. Justin, you want to know if a leopard was fully stretched out, how long would it be? Well, the length of a leopard from tail to nose, I'm going to say is probably about 6 feet. I'm just going to look that up for you. But probably about 6 feet, I'd say. Maybe a little bit longer with the tail. Without the tail, probably about 4.5 feet long. They're not very tall. Would you say that's about right, Brian?
Yeah, I'd say so.
I'll just look it up for you quickly, everyone. Just in case I've told you a lie. Which would be dreadful, wouldn't it, Brian? Mm. Horrible.
I would say 8 feet with a tail.
Would you? Mm. That long? Mm. Oh dear. I always hate it when that happens, because normally I'm wrong. Female, 140 centimetres for a huge female. No, can't be that. That's 1.4 metres, yeah. Which is, yeah. Yeah, that's probably about right then. That's head to back. I don't think that's including the tail. Sorry, everybody. You've now got me thinking. I haven't been asked that before, certainly not for a long time, and now I'm desperately flummoxed. HB, head and body length. Right, there we go. T is tail. Right, so there we go. I can tell you exactly. A small female, 164 centimeters in length. That is 1.6 meters, which is roughly 5'5". A very big leopard, including tail, ooh, this is much bigger, would be 250 centimeters, 2.5 meters, which would be roughly 8 feet. So that would be a very big leopardess. We'll put it somewhere in between that for this one. I don't think she's particularly big. I don't think she's particularly small either. So we're going to make her at roughly... What do you think, Brian? I'm going to say... We'll give her an even 180 centimetres, 1.8, just under 6 foot. There you are. Phew, I'm glad neither of us were wrong, Brian. Aren't you relieved? Yes. It's very nice when the books give you a very wide range of options. Now, they do change in size, of course, leopards. I don't mean she will change in size. She will remain roughly the same size for the rest of her days. But if you go down towards the Cape, in the Cape Mountains, you'll get much smaller leopards there. And into the Middle East, they'll be even smaller there. And I suppose these leopards are pretty much also some of the bigger ones that you'll find. So maybe she's a bit bigger than 6 feet. There are also some of the sleepier ones, as you can see. It's interesting how her colour seems to have changed slightly as the light has started to fade. Doesn't look quite so brown, a bit more copper, but she's definitely got less yellow in her. Right, Pajamas Patterson is still knocking about. She's just finished her shoot, so let's go and find out how that went for her. I think we don't have much time left on the drive, so I think we'll sit with her until the end of the drive and enjoy her new company. Let's go and find out what Jamie's got to tell you.
And what a lovely surprise to hear that, you know, 5 minutes after we left the dam, the leopard came out to drink there. I'm not going to take it personally at all. You know, we only went around twice, and then the leopard came out 5 minutes later. But that's okay, it's nothing personal, it's just timing. Anyway, so while you've been busy with James and that lovely newcomer, we've been doing some couple of, you know, surprise thingies, behind the scenes shoots and all kinds of things. Chandra tried to attack me with the drone. It was entertaining, to say the least. Chandra hanging from a branch was also pretty entertaining. Anyway, moving on, we've had some lovely times, but we are back up and running and we are racing. Sorry. I got overexcited. Toting. That'll help. Sorry about that, everybody. Okay, let's calm myself down to a mild panic. Thank you, Jandre. That's the last of your water. It's very most generous. Now, I do want to try and get to where the lions are, but I did not realize that James was busy doing things that side with the leopard. So we shall sneak around. I think we'll give him a miss altogether. Don't want to run the risk of startling that leopard, although it sounds like she's relaxed perfectly. I think we'll go around. Ooh, we'll go around the other way and see whether or not the lions have decided to pop out. So we got a radio call while we were busy doing other things. And the lions put in a very brief appearance on Gowrie Cutline before making their way back once again into that impenetrable drainage line. I know that Mr. Henry did a superb job yesterday of somehow managing to circumnavigate. I don't know how he managed. Oh, it was yesterday. It was this morning. I don't know how he managed to get in and out of there in the way that he did, but he did. And I'm most impressed. But he suggested perhaps we didn't do a repeat performance this afternoon on the basis that it would be terribly tragic if Wendy or Rusty were to break. We will not try and push in there. Those of you who are keeping an eye on the Juma Dam camera, you were rewarded this afternoon with a leopard. There is a very good chance that the lions are going to pop out. It's been quite a hot afternoon. Little Franklin? Here we go. Thank you. Can I come past, please? It saw me coming and just sat in the middle of the road. A crested Franklin. And somewhere, listening to the sounds ahead of us, an elephant. Let's go find it. As our Franklin slowly disappears, there's definitely the sounds of something rustling around in there. Maybe an elephant, maybe it's the hippo. Could be. He might have ducked out of the pan. He was there yesterday evening. He's been missing today. Perhaps he's making his way back again. Oopsie. Sorry. Sorry, Kirst. Nearly smacked her with a branch. And a really lovely question from Jen B as we approach the elephants that have been rustling around, which is, does it not feel odd speaking to people that I can't see? The answer is, Jen B, not anymore, but it did. It really, really did. It took me a little while to get used to the whole idea of not having people on the back. I mean, not that our cameramen are not people, although, you know, Chandra's hair is a bit debatable. Aww.
That's so sweet.
It's a pleasure, Chandra. Shame. No, I'm being mean now. No, not that our cameramen are not people, but not having guests on the back asking actual questions. It did take me a while to get used to. And it's something I really thought I'd miss, having guests on the back, and that hasn't been the case, because the questions and the comments that come through from people actually has made it like you are all sitting on the back of the vehicle with us. And that, I think, is really special. We say that all the time, but it is actually the case. As we watch this elephant peacefully feed. So Jen, yes, it did feel odd in the beginning. It doesn't anymore. It's like having you all on the back with me. And of course, every time you hear a familiar name and you know which people are passionate about what things, and it's a very special little family that the Safari Live family has going on, and our Wild Earth family. I know, for example, that Gracie absolutely loves elephants, and every time I see elephants, I hope that 9-year-old Gracie is watching and enjoying them with me. And in a wonderful turn of affairs, Gracie is watching this afternoon. So Gracie, it's lovely to have you on board, and I'm sorry I've been absent, but I hope that you're enjoying an elephant sighting for the last few moments of our sunset safari, because there's nothing quite like the peace of an elephant sighting as we sit and listen to the sounds of the evening descend. And I attempt to hold back the hacking coughs that would totally destroy the atmosphere. Thank you. And RJ is deeply concerned once again about our solitary elephant bull, wondering where the herd is. RJ, don't stress, the elephant herd is not far away at all. This is a young elephant, a young male, so he is either on the outskirts of a herd or he is sort of starting to move about with a bachelor group. So when young males get to a certain age, then they move off on their own and they start a life separate from the herd into which they were born. Kind of like adult children moving out and leaving home. Male elephants do something similar. It's not something that the females do. Now he's going to disappear, but I can hear more elephants ahead, and I know that we're running out of time on this lovely sunset safari. We're just going to scoot forward and go and get some more of them around the corner. Hello, Ellies. So there are other Ellies, RJ. They are around. Let's try and find us a nice view for the last few moments. So this afternoon's been an interesting one, hasn't it? We spent an age waiting for the elephants to come out at the Galago Pan, and it looks as though they've all just done just that. And then we spent sort of a good few minutes circling. Ah, wonderful. Circling the pan, only for the leopard to come out 2 seconds later. How lovely is this? Absolutely beautiful. There's the rest of the herd, the females and their youngsters. Disappearing like grey ghosts into the dusky gloom. One of my best times to enjoy an elephant sighting is when you can barely see them. They're just massive shapes looming out of the darkness. And the very peaceful sounds of them munching away. Joe in Wales in the United Kingdom, you get the honour of probably the last question of this evening. As far as I know, male elephants don't feel massive pain or discomfort in terms of going into their must cycle, nor do the females in terms of their estrus cycle. That being said, I don't know that completely for certain. I'm certain that for must bull elephants that get swelling around their temporal glands, that's probably a little bit uncomfortable. And we certainly know that they're more irascible than they might otherwise be. They're a bit grumpy, short-tempered, and that's their hormones speaking. So perhaps, whilst they don't necessarily feel major physical pain, they might feel like emotional teenagers. And I think that the females you'll probably find feel much the same. Elephants are such complex creatures that we can't discount the level of emotional sort of complications that they have within their lives. And just like that, our beautiful elephant is slowly disappearing off into the darkness, and we're going to let them move off. And it is time for us once again at the end of the sunset safari to say a big farewell to all of you. And I'm going to say my goodbyes and my thank yous on behalf of James, as well as, of course, Brian, who is on camera with him. So a big thank you to Jandre for his fantastic camera work, as always, and his hilarious chasing me around the field like with the drone, as well as to Lou and Jerry in final control, and most importantly, our valuable viewers who sit on the back with us and send through your questions. Have a wonderful day wherever you are in the world, and we'll catch up with you tomorrow on the Sunrise Safari. Bye-bye, everybody.